democratic, people started to be enslaved by their own countrymen. Now, the first example is the most shocking example, I would say, is the rise in sex slave and also prostitution in Western Europe. Women from the former Soviet bloc were lured into prostitution and sex slavery by the mafia. These women were desperate because with the collapse of the communist economy, they were unemployed. I mean, women unemployment went from virtually zero before the fall of the wall to 80%. These women were desperate. They had to feed their own children, so they became prostitutes. So this is just one of the examples. But we also see this phenomenon in the past. I mean, decolonization actually boosted slavery. As foreign powers withdrew from the colonies, people were enslaved by their own countrymen. And we see it in Africa, we see it in Asia.
Give more examples.
Well, I think one interesting example, for example, is what's happening in a certain sector, for example, the cocoa. Production in the Ivory Coast. The majority of the cocoa that we eat, it is actually produced by young kids which have been enslaved in the plantation of the Ivory Coast. Ivory Coast is the largest producer of cocoa. Now, why does this happen? This happens for a series of complicated reasons, which are also the economic dependency of Africa from the industrialized countries. So, I mean,
these are large multinational corporations, the cocoa companies.
Absolutely. Cocoa companies controlled by a group of multinationals. So is coffee. Coffee is controlled by two main multinationals, which is Nestle and Starbucks. So sometimes when we drink our coffee, we don't know that this coffee is actually produced by slaves. It is produced through exploitation of growers in Africa, and this is because of the globalization market.
And what about going back in history to slavery in this country, in the United States?
Well, I think what we're facing today is something very, very similar to what's happening in these countries, centuries ago. Because when I talk about slavery, I do not talk about a new form of slavery. I talk about people who are deprived of their freedom, who are forced to work for the slave traders, who are given only the sustenance to survive and nothing else. It is through slavery.
Do you view the U.S. economy as a rogue economy?
Yes, of course, the U.S. economy, it is a rogue economy. All Western economies at the moment are rogue economy for the simple reason that politics has lost control of the economy. And I'll give you an example. This decision of President Bush, for example, to give a tax rebate could end up being a rogue maneuver without even the president or the administration wanted that. So we give a tax rebate to people in order to boost consumption. But if these people buy products which are produced abroad, for example, in the Far East and China, the benefit of this new consumption is not going to stay inside the U.S. economy. And that's one aspect. The other aspect is how many people will use the tax rebate to pay back part of their credit card debt? Because, bankruptcy, personal bankruptcy in this country in 2006 was, the rate of growth was higher than the rate of growth of the GDP. This is a country which is in serious economic problems.
You talk about high tech as a mixed blessing. Why?
Well, high tech is a mixed blessing because, to a certain extent, it gave us the possibility to spread information through the internet, of course, all over the world. Here we are, and people can watch us, which is fantastic. But at the same time, the internet has become a new vehicle for theft, for criminal activities, prostitution, pornography, and so on and so forth. I mean, for example, pornography, child pornography is the biggest business in the internet. So why is it Miss Blexing? Because nobody can control the internet. So that's a very good example of rogue economics.
Back here in this country, the bailout of Bear Stearns, the intervention of the Fed, your analysis of that?
I think that's very much in line with what has happened in the United Kingdom with Northern Rock. The panic at the moment is that if one bank falls, then we're going to have a domino effect. So this is exactly what has happened in 1929. The crash of 1929 was not really the cause of the depression. The cause of the depression was the failure of banks and people panicking. So what the Fed is trying to do is trying to prevent another massive failure of banks. Now, why Bernstein ended up in that situation, that's the key question. Why was a bank allowed to borrow way over the amount of money that could actually pay back? This is the key question. And the answer is lack of regulation. And even this proposal that is on the table today,
I mean, we'll have 5 seconds.
Well, even this proposal, it would be only a temporary, it would be a band-aid. It's not going to solve the problem.
I want to thank you very much for joining us, Loretta Napoliani. Her book is called Rogue Economics. And that does it for today's broadcast. Democracy Now! Is produced by Mike Burke. Happy birthday, Mike. Sharifa Gokhadoos, Sarah Mata, Anjali Kamat, Jeffrey Hagerman, Steve Martinez, Nicole Salazar, Hani Massoud, Robbie Karen. I'm Amy Goodman. Our website, democracynow.org. Thanks for joining us.